Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us here at this NDC webinar, looking ahead for spring semester. Today, we will be talking about graduation, internships, study abroad opportunities, and campus access. Let's move on to the next slide. Before we move on, I want to do an access check and look over our agenda. Today, please use the Q&A feature to ask any questions of our team. Each presenter will be giving visual descriptions of themselves. And at the end of each topic, resources discussed will be typed in the chat. At the end of this webinar, we will offer a QR code where you can earn a badge for your attendance today. Next, here we see the agenda. We'll be talking about campus access, graduation, study abroad, and internships. Then we will allow about 15 minutes for some questions and answers for our team. Next slide, please. I would like to begin today by recognizing Indigenous communities. We know that everyone joining today are joining from different places across the country. We would like to encourage you to find out what land it is you live and work on. We will provide resources in the chat box that allow you to see what Indigenous land you are currently on. And let's move to the next slide. At the foundational core of National Deaf Center, we believe that access is more than accommodations, and that deaf students have a right to be included in all aspects of campus life. Let's move to the next slide. When we talk about campus access, we need to recognize that accessibility is not limited to just the classroom. It is instead the full range of programs that are offered on campus, including activities outside the classroom, campus events, student organizations, and student housing. It's important to be aware of the community where your campus resides. We'd like to encourage you to encourage your campuses to include the deaf community when it comes to sports, theater, and graduation activities. Let's look at this next slide. Disability services has some standard practices, many of which I'm sure you are aware. Let's first look at your institutional responsibility. To know what your responsibilities are, you want to refer back to your legal obligations, as well as your institutional mission, and think about who it is that you serve. It's important to have policies and procedures in place for the different accommodations and accessibility needs. For example, captioning. Does your campus have a captioning policy? How is it that students can request access when needed? What about interpreting contracts? Do you hire interpreters through independent contracts, or do you use an agency? Is there a place online for students and community members to provide feedback on accessibility that is either working well or not working? It is important to recognize the open process that should be happening among staff and students. There are a lot of nuances to consider when a student is receiving accommodations on campus. You want to frequently check in with that student, check in with the interpreters, make sure that everyone is satisfied with the interpreter's competency with the course content. You want to make sure that everything shown in the classroom, media-wise, is captioned, and that any on-campus events are accessible for a deaf audience. Okay, let's move down to the next slide. Person-centered practices refer to the respect of and the needs of individuals and planning for what their goals are. We also want to honor and respect individual communication methods the deaf student prefers. Remember that effective communication is key to ensuring access on campus. Centralized funding and decentralized funding are two different ways that campuses typically structure paying for access. A decentralized system can sometimes be a barrier because the brunt of the cost comes to the disability services office when it comes to access for deaf students. You want to ensure that the funding will cover a continuity of resources. When you have a decentralized system, it can cause barriers where the centralized system shares that cost across the entire campus instead of just in one office. Make sure you have an area on your website where students can provide feedback of what has worked well and what hasn't worked. Maybe areas where they can offer suggestions for improvement. Let's move on to the next slide. Here we have a few tips and suggestions for disability services providers and for campus events specifically. It's important that disability services office have a connection with the office that manages events that happen on campus. We recommend that the Disability Services Office partner with student organizations so that they can model what access should look like and what these student organizations should be planning for. Remember to check in frequently with that deaf student. That interactive process with the students never stops. Consider your surrounding community and any access decisions for events such as graduation ceremonies or theater productions. Finally, make sure that any media shown on campus is captioned. Maybe you have a public-facing TV with announcements across campus. that should be captioned so that deaf students have equal access to it. Okay, with that, I'm going to turn this over to our next panelist, Kate.
Hello, hello, everyone. My name is Kate Lewinsky. Oh, sorry, a little difficulty there. I use she, her, hers pronouns, and I'm on the NDC help team. I am a Caucasian woman with blonde hair pulled back into a bun. I am wearing a gray shirt with a collar with a dark gray background. I'm here today to discuss graduation and what exactly that will look like in common practices with the National Deaf Center. Prior planning is going to be key when it comes to accessibility and making sure that the experience is great for students, families, and visitors. Different institutions have, of course, provided both interpreters, transcription services, without having to request specifically the accommodations. If your institution is not ready to accept this type of approach, it is important that you share the needed information, especially of how to make those requests and who the coordinator is in advance. The communication should be clear. The 504 and Americans with Disabilities Act does require institutions to ensure that public events are fully accessible. Each college or university may have their own internal process, so it does vary as to what that will look like and who's responsible for the coordination. Now, the ADA or disability services may or may not be those who coordinate, but they may have the funding at one location. However, a different school, it may be on the host for the graduation to provide those accommodations. Now on the screen, you see there is a picture of an example of possibility of what universal design may look like. So there may be captions on a stage with the speaker standing with an interpreter as well. This way, the visual access is there and available. So that's just one example of what universal design for accessibility could possibly look like. Next slide, please. When planning for graduation, we do have four tips that we'd like to share with you all. Our first tip is a planning committee. So it is key to make sure that there is a person who is experienced with accessibility, especially when it comes to deaf and hard of hearing people, and make sure they're involved. That way we can discuss what access looks like. And the committee members have a key stakeholder that they can discuss their access concerns and needs with. Next, we do have marketing. That plan should be put out in advance and clearly communicate what accommodations will be provided, if there are going to be some provided without a request, or if a request is required to provide access. Communication access accommodation, of course, you can find on a website or maybe even within the graduation materials themselves. If you do require a request to be submitted, be sure to include in specifics who is responsible for coordinating, their name, and how to contact them. Now, you would also want to include a due date. For example, perhaps a timeline for those accommodations to ensure that they will be provided. However, if you are receiving any last minute requests, your institute is, or school or university is, required to try your best to provide those accommodations. Communication access and technology. So there are communication access points that we would recommend, for example, about the interpreters. Make sure that they are provided with materials and make sure they're also invited to those rehearsals that will take place prior to the big day. So if there is a plan for, let's say, the graduation presenter, they'll be mentioning names of the speakers or even the graduates themselves. Make sure that information is shared, where the access providers will stand, where they will provide services, et cetera. At the same time, you want to make sure, if needed, assisted listening devices are available for borrow. So you want to make sure that devices or access is clear and easily available. So if a person perhaps has a hearing aid or a cochlear implant or depends on visual access, everyone is satisfied. If there's going to be a projection or any type of film shown at graduation, make sure captions are readily available. Lastly, but not least, technology. If you have a plan to perhaps live stream the graduation, be sure to take advantage and make sure visual access can be provided. You can either have an interpreter, let's say side by side, or even picture in picture. This way, the live stream can be fully accessible and easily seen as well. When discussing the plans in advance for graduation, we do have some practices that is person-centered that you should consider. Again, we strongly recommend having both interpreters and captions or stream text available without having to make a request. This way, you're able to schedule in advance and reduce the stress as we get closer to those big days and all of the planning that goes into it and logistics. And that also allows the deaf people to come and enjoy without having that additional stress of, well, who do I contact? When will I hear back from them, et cetera? We want to make sure that your events are equal access, and that for us is a win-win for you as well. Consider each of the different access needs for different groups, including, let's say, deaf audience members and their families. You want to make sure that the access to the interpreter is provided, as well as if you have a deaf graduate. So you may have to schedule two separate teams of interpreters to provide access, one specifically for the audience and another team that would be with that student or that graduate. So they can have that time to interact with other students, to get directions or how they're going to march in, for example. So you want to make sure that they are there, the interpreters are there to provide that access so that the student can see visually and be fully engaged in their big day. Next slide, please. If you still have any additional questions and concerns about plans for graduation, what it could potentially look like, you could perhaps have a face-to-face graduation or even a live stream. You can watch our webinar that we did host last year about graduation. That was from about March of 2022. So you can watch that or even find some more information on our website and contact us directly. If you'd like to have those additional discussions, we can schedule something if you shoot us an email, and we can set up an available schedule time for more of a consultant for your plans and your big day so we can ensure access is available. I am now going to turn over to my colleague, Lorianne. Welcome to the stage.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lore Canast. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I'm a white woman with long blonde hair. I'm wearing glasses. I'm wearing a gray shirt with a black undershirt. It's short sleeve. I have silver dangly earrings and have a dark kind of gray backdrop behind me. I'm really excited to share a little bit about study abroad. We all know that the planning involved with studying abroad is very detailed and quite different than this typical college semester scheduling. There are many things to consider for students who are studying abroad. So you want to, we want to encourage you to start this before we get into the five key questions. We want you to consider thinking through this very, very early on and use a collaborative approach to ensure every step of the way is accessible and inclusive to that deaf student. So there are five key questions that we suggest you think through. The first is what? What type of internship is it? Is it a group trip? Is it a group travel? Is it something like that where we're close to home? When is it? How long does it last? It could be a week or 2 weeks. It could be a full semester or just for the summer. Maybe it's even during the middle of the semester, which could impact the service providers from other students' classes. So all of those are things to consider when you're planning and scheduling for that. The next key question is who? Is the student going alone on an internship, or are they a part of a class? Are they attending with a conference? Are they going as a group to all do an internship together? All of those who questions are important. Next is why. Why are they doing this internship? Is it a part of their degree requirement? Are they presenting at a conference? Are they presenting their research work? And then finally, how? You know, there are hands-on activities, there are tours, lectures, many different ways that a study abroad could look. We have seen research teams go and do archaeological digs in very hot desert climates where they may be camping or rock climbing. Others are on a boat for marine biology research. That means you need to get a service provider willing to go into those areas and those climates. Let's move to the next slide. Study abroad includes three phases. The pre-planning phase is where you will be heavily involved. This poster here shows the three phases. The pre-phase and the planning phase is where you really look into those logistics. What will the day-to-day schedule be? Maybe the student will be attending lectures all morning and then be in the field in the afternoon. Will there be walking tours that require a lot of walking? You want details of each day of that internship so that you can best plan for service provision. Next, you want to look at accommodations. With that student, you want to determine who will be there. Will you have an hourly staff member who goes on this internship? Will you have a contracted service provider? Will there be someone in that location, or maybe a combination of each of those? Those are things to consider. Once you figure that out, whether you're using staff or contract interpreters or on-site interpreters, you also want to look at what interpreters have certifications. Now, some states require specific licensure for service providers, and you want to make sure the service providers, if they're from a different state, follow whatever licensure requirement is. If they're studying abroad in another country, those service providers need a passport to be able to travel. There's also consideration of content knowledge. Do these service providers have the content knowledge needed for them to provide accurate services? Next, we've got to look at funding. Of course, there is cost involved in all of this, and it takes a lot of programming. What will your department cover? What can be included for service providers? For example, let's say that there is a tour and there is a cost to that. How will that cost factor in for the service provider? Will you also have to pay their price for the tour, or will that be waived since they're providing a service? You want to ensure that your contract with these service providers includes room and board, travel expenses, and other incidental fees that may come up, such as museum tour costs, ticket costs. Maybe your service provider will charge a daily flat rate, or maybe they charge an hourly rate. You may want to look into some cost sharing partnerships. Maybe if another college provides this a similar or same internship program, you can share the cost. Externally, you can share the cost as well. MIUSA is the Mobility International USA organization, and they work with study abroad students to ensure accessibility. You may want to partner with an organization like that. You also want to plan for emergencies. I'll let you know from my experience, emergencies do happen. If there is an emergency, what will you do if a service provider is injured or becomes ill and can no longer continue with their role because they need medical attention? What if that happens to the deaf student? What if there is a family emergency and either the student or the service provider has to go back home? You want to think through and plan for all of these possible scenarios. So that's the heaviest part of your work, which is the pre-planning. Now, during the event, you want to check in with the student, check in with the service provider and the program leads to just make sure everything is running smoothly. If there are any concerns, what types of adjustments can you make? So checking in frequently will help you resolve any issues that might arise. Then the after phase, when that student comes back from their study abroad, allow them an opportunity to provide feedback. That will allow you to make adjustments and improve along the way for the next students that do study abroad. Let's move to the next slide. This slide is a copy of 4 pages from one of our documents. It's a checklist or a toolkit that we have offered. This toolkit will walk you through who to contact, when to contact them. It will guide you in developing an emergency backup plan. And this is something that can be very helpful for you for next time you have a study abroad student. Let's move to the next slide. So when planning, you want to remain person-centered. Think about that student and what their goals are for this internship. What are they hoping to take away from that experience? The student must be included from the very beginning of the planning all the way through to the end. When it comes to deciding who the service providers will be, that student needs to be involved. If that student is flying and they're talking with their peers about the what will be happening on the plane, you want to make sure that they tell you what's important to them. Maybe there are social opportunities. We know those social opportunities on study abroad trips like this are as critical as the content. And you want to make sure that they have access to communication after hours during those critical social moments. Their communication preferences are so important to consider. When they're going to a specific location, you want to make sure the service provider is familiar with the culture, history, and customs of wherever it is they are traveling. Those are all things to really consider and make sure that the student has a completely equitable access. Collaborations are another important part of all of this. This isn't all on the Disability Services Office to plan for. You have to include other departments, whatever college that student is a part of, other faculty members and people who play a role in that study abroad opportunity should all share in the planning phases. Now, my last bit of advice to you is that planning is critical. You have to include everyone, including the student. And it does take a lot of educating. You'll find yourself needing to be patient to explain and re-explain to people you come across. And that will happen again and again with each site, with each program. So be flexible. Remember to be creative and be willing to adapt as you go along. Okay, at this point, I will turn it over to Tia to talk about internships. Tia?
Thank you so much, Laura. This is Tia Ivanko, and I'm the co-director for the National Deaf Center. I am a Black female with light brown hair that is wavy today, glasses that are, I guess, sebon colored, perhaps, and a green shirt, as well as a Black background. My pronouns are she, her. I'm here to take a little time to discuss about internships and all of practicums, clinicals, apprenticeships, and all of the things that fall under those work-based learning opportunities. Each of those opportunities, internships, apprenticeships, clinicals, et cetera, are valuable learning opportunities for students. And truly, it's for all students. It's knowledge application, it's hands-on learning skills, some environmental working skills that are learned. So we want to make sure that each person has that opportunity to experience similar to their hearing peers. Deaf students should be able to join any opportunity that is presented, and it's important that they are able to join, because you don't want it to be where they have a lack of experience or unaware, or we don't want any barriers or unconscious bias to prevent those students from having the experience that they should, rather than people introducing as, well, I heard it would be difficult. Allow everyone to experience for themselves and welcome the students into those spaces. It is important that we as professionals have high expectations for those students, students that are able to complete the requirements and be able to engage in different types of experiences. Of course, we will want to provide accommodations as needed. Moving on to the next slide. Making sure that the internships themselves are accessible, that is just as important when the planning stages in advance. You want to make sure that the intern, work-based learning experience, whichever it may be, make sure that they are able to start early and you can think of services that may be needed rather than wait until the last minute and have those surprises. When you plan in advance, by the time the students come and are ready to discuss, you have the necessary answers. There are some standard practices that we do suggest. It is key for each person to meet together, including the students, the supervisors, the program director, if needed, and even those who will be supervising in person or on site. During that discussion, we will talk about the students. Let the students share what they need, what it may look like for them on a day-to-day. Allow others to ask questions of the student and their experience, because this will become a partnership and everyone is going to be working together for the best possible experience for those students. We also want to keep in mind communication and how it can be effective. Now, we may say deaf person, however, the communication needs does vary on the individual, depending on the experience, their background, the situation, and what's happening in that moment. So a dialogue is important. As a disability service provider, it's key to have that flexibility. There are times, sometimes you may have to think outside of the box and be creative with what is possible, and that conversation will happen with the students. Now, we have noticed that there are some accommodations that require payment. That may be interpreters, hiring them, a captionist. There are fees involved. So often we get the question of, well, who is responsible? Well, it's important to have that dialogue and discussion early, and it may depend on the experience itself. So if it's a student program and it's required for graduation, and it is an academic requirement, that means the college or university would be responsible. If the opportunity is being offered by an organization or an employer, that means the student is being hired as an employee, let's say. That means the organization would be responsible to pay for access. And they are protected under the American Disabilities Act to provide equal access for all employees. You can look deeper into that and see if it's a requirement of the program or if the option is available and it's a requirement of the organization. I do also want to recommend checking in more about an organization called Job Accommodation Network, or JAN, J-A-N. They are available to provide consultation or counseling, and workplace settings, they are quite experienced in there. So internships, there's a lot of information that JAN would be able to provide about how to provide access and make sure the workplace or the setting is accessible. Moving on to the next slide. As my colleagues have mentioned, it is key to focus on the individual. The student and their needs and their overall experience is going to be primary in this process. It's important that any institution, internship site, or even VR, vocational rehabilitation, do include the student and try and identify any possible barriers and develop a plan to ensure that the student's internship is truly a beneficial experience. Each of those different stakeholders must come together to support that student to make sure that they are able to thrive in that setting. We also want to make sure that we're checking in regularly, excuse me. You can't think that the whole no news is good news, because that's not always the case. If a student's going to the internship or work-based experience, there's a lot of power dynamic in those type of situations. So if the students feel that they are unable to speak up or they're not sure about what to do, it would be key for the student to know how to, let's say, share complaints. They may be concerned about retaliation or losing their job, so they may just try and stick it out, and it may not be the best thing for them if they just don't say anything. As a disability service provider, you may think, well, I haven't heard anything, everything must be going well. However, it's key to do those check-ins periodically with those students to keep that dialogue open, to make sure that the entire experience is satisfactory, as well as checking afterwards, so you know exactly what's going on and they've had the full benefit of the experience. Next page. Here are a few tips and suggestions for you all to keep in mind. First thing is to build a relationship. This is key for any situation, but especially with those students who are going out into our workforce. You want to develop that rapport so that the students do truly trust you and they can share that information, ask questions that they may be afraid to do, and even share some concerns if they do come about. You want to be able to know what's working and what's not working in their day-to-day experiences. You also want to work together to set those clear goals and expectations. That may require some flexibility or even creativity, because there may be an approach that matches one student but not the other, or the approach that worked once upon a time may not work now. We've learned with time that change will happen, so that flexibility is going to be key in our roles. Keep in mind also, because it worked for one student, that does not mean it's necessarily going to work for the next student. Each deaf person is different and their needs are different, so you would need to base your support on the specifics. We don't want to have those assumptions and our own unconscious bias to intrude our ability to provide services. So that's actually it for my part. Thank you all so much. I look forward to the Q&A at the end. I do suggest check out some of those resources related to internship, apprenticeships, work-based learning, because it's a valuable piece for our students. We will have our Q&A session at the end. I'm going to go ahead and invite our evaluator onto the screen, Megan DeMarcus. Edmonds. And Megan is going to explain a bit more of the importance of your feedback for us here at NDC so that we can ensure that we're providing the best services for you all. Turning it over to Megan.
Thank you, Tia. My name is Megan Edmonds, and I work on the evaluation team at the Meadows Center for Preventing Educational Risk. And we work with NDC to gather feedback from their events and activities. So we have a few poll questions for you today about this webinar. And out of respect for your time, we've kept the polls short, just a few questions. And your feedback is very important for helping NDC's staff and their leadership and their funders to better understand what's working well and what could be improved. So thank you in advance for responding to the poll questions, and we'll pop those questions up now. Okay, we can scroll through to the next question. Oh, let's see. All right, now people are answering, so thank you for responding. Thank you, everyone, for your feedback. Appreciate it.
All righty. Thank you so much, Megan. And thank you all for participating. We are now going to open up our Q&A. I do want to invite my colleagues, Latoya, to come up on screen. And each of those presenters that you've seen just a few moments ago. Latoya says, hello, hello, everyone. I am Latoya. I will go ahead and give a little bit of description of myself. I am a Black woman with hoop earrings. My hair is black up into a bun on top of my head. I have a teal color short sleeve shirt on as well. So we're going to go ahead and start with the questions that we do have. So we typically receive some common questions through our webinars. So I will go ahead and start there and we'll move forward. First question. Fundraising. What is the recommendation for campus access?
Okay, this is Ben. So when we talk about centralized funding, we say that it's a best practice because with centralized funding, providing accessibility, it ensures that there is a consistent funding stream that will cover the cost of interpreters, captions, note takers. Centralized funding is based on the entire campus's budget rather than just one department. So when we see decentralized funding, they require each individual department to pay for access when it comes to their department. And you know, each department has a limited amount of funding. So that is why we recommend centralized budget method.
Thank you so much, Ben. We'll move down to the next question. Student organizations have been requesting sign language interpreters for each of their events, but often no deaf students or deaf people show up. The interpreters do not want to accept those type of assignments any longer. What should we do?
That's a good question. This is Ben. Really, for any campus event, you want to make sure it is advertised, whether it be on physical advertisements posted around school or online. You want a section there that explains to people where they can find access, where they can make a request for access. That way, those potential audience members can know where there will be interpreters or where there will be certain types of accommodations provided. You can also announce when you already have those services in place so that a participant knows they don't have to even make a request. So you want to put that in the advertisements. What types of accessibility will be there? And advertise that in everything you do, both on campus and online. Tia?
Hi, this is Tia speaking. I just want to add that the situation that we're speaking of, if the interpreter doesn't see the deaf people there, doesn't mean that they shouldn't be working. If they are assigned to that opportunity, they should continue to interpret because it's a priority for not only the students, for the college. The access should be there. So if any student, let's say, are walking by, they're able to be fully engaged without that additional responsibility of requesting for access. So if you are truly trying to find a way to fully have an open campus, so if the interpreter is there, I do recommend just go ahead and have them to interpret. We want to make sure that any person can be involved in any activity at any time.
Thank you, Tia.
So the next question is from one of our attendees here. The question is from Francine. It says, could you address the issue of captioning all graduates' names at commencement ceremonies? Is there a more common practice as of recent? This is Kate. That is a good question. It does come up pretty often. It kind of depends a bit, though. So it depends on your approach and who is hosting the said graduation or commencement ceremony. For open and general access, if you're not sure of who's in the audience, it may be best to just have the names projected on the screen. I know other times the QR code could be made readily available for the event. That way the names could show up in a separate device. If, let's say, there is a graduate and the family wants to know when their name is called, you would have to know that the audience, it's going to be a number of names, and that is a lot for the interpreters to sign. However, the family may be able to ask the interpreters, hey, could you let us know when we get to that row so we can identify our student and scream and yell and applaud. So there's a number of different approaches. There is no common one. It truly depends on who is there, who is in need of the access as well. Thank you so much, Kate. This is Latoya again. Next question is from Michelle. Michelle has asked the study abroad students, if they want to go out on their own, do we provide interpreters for elective group outings? For example, meals or even shopping, et cetera?
I'll answer that. This is Laura speaking. You know, deaf students rarely have an opportunity to participate in those social opportunities with their hearing peers. So this is a good example of that. If everyone is going out to go shopping, of course they want to be included in that. So that is where we recommend that if a student wants to attend a social event, that the accommodation work out, whatever works best for that student. You know, they may have had an accommodation such as interpreters for something like a lecture. Maybe they want something different for this event. So always ask what their communication preferences are and how much access it is that they require for that. So we do encourage the students to take advantage of all of those extra opportunities that really run the entire gamut of the entire program, not just the, you know, 9 to 5 program, so to speak, but those extra activities as well. Again, it's all about providing an equitable access to those deaf students, just the same as what their hearing counterparts receive.